Welcome, welcome, welcome to the third annual Take Back Your Internet Party / panel by Golden Frog. This topic, apparently I've been writing about this for 10 years. Am I that old, actually? And things have changed a whole lot in just the last year. So it's going to be exciting to sort of break down how that happened, what comes next. I'll introduce our panels in just a minute, but the organizers asked me to remind you all that the hashtag here is Take Back Your Internet. We apologize for the length of that. And you can send us questions via Twitter, and somebody, not me, I don't think, is going to be looking at those, and we'll try to answer them when we get to them. There's some sponsors who help make this possible. There's Spider Oak, Zero Knowledge Cloud Storage, I believe they're on the black phone, Data Foundry, based right here in Austin, and GigaNews, the world's leading Usenet provider. I remember using Usenet. And I think there are a few advocacy groups here, the Electronic Frontier Foundation, Center for Democracy and Technology, Engine Advocacy, and the I2 Coalition. And the folks on the panel. To my left is Marvin Amori. The cheat sheet here says famed internet lawyer. You wrote this, didn't you?
I didn't write that.
Somebody actually described him as the net neutrality whisperer. I think I said you were the Kaiser Soze of net neutrality. There's Edward Henigin, CTO of Data Foundry. Gigi Sohn, the Special Counsel for Public Affairs at the Federal Communications Commission. Chip Pickering, CEO of Comptel. James Waterworth, Vice President of the Computer and Communications Industry Association Europe. And I'm Rob Pegorero. I do a column on policy for Yahoo Tech. I also do a Q&A column for USA Today. You may see me writing at the Wirecutter every now and then. And here I am. And I guess one last note here. We thank you for coming out at this time. I like to joke that the worst panel time slot is right before the reception. In this case, we've solved that by having the reception and the panel be at the same time. Please remember to tip your bartenders. That's a form of paid prioritization we are okay with. So I think we got to start. You know, we've had this historic FCC vote, which how much money would you put on that happening a year ago?
I would have put
a dollar
money on it, but it was very unlikely.
So it's happened, and the question we have to ask next is, what's next? By which I mean, who's going to sue to overturn, try to get these regulations overturned first? Will it be a cable company? Will it be Verizon? If it's Verizon, what will the rest of Big Telecom be muttering behind their back, since it was Verizon's suit that arguably brought us to this point by getting some not very strong net neutrality regulations thrown out in court and forcing the FCC to start over? And because I like to ask multi-part questions, what if the FCC's losing streak in net neutrality court cases continues? Then what? Gigi, do you want to take the lead on that?
Well, look. All I know is this. Somebody's going to sue. I'm not sure it's going to be one of the big companies because the last two times they sued and lost, it didn't work out so well for them. So it may well be one of the trade associations instead, and that makes things interesting because the trade associations don't all speak with one voice. So the Wireless Industry Trade Association has members who think Title II isn't so bad, right? Sprint and T-Mobile. So I wouldn't presume that any particular company or any particular, you know, trade association is going to sue. I can't imagine nobody is going to sue, but it actually it actually makes a difference who sues and who doesn't. If the big companies sit this one out, it actually looks different to a court than if the trade associations do. But I'll also say this. Nobody's thinking about losing because the FCC has done the thing that the Supreme Court and the last court that struck down our 2010 rules, the D.C. Circuit Court of Appeals, that's a federal court of appeals in Washington, said that we could do, right? We could reclassify broadband internet access as a telecommunications service if we also wanted to adopt the strongest possible net neutrality rules. So I'm not really worried, and I was very heartened to see, I think it was the New York Times, a law professor named Jim Spada, in Northwestern, not a fan of net neutrality, basically say, the FCC's on really solid ground, so we're planning on winning.
You know, Rob, just to follow up on what Gigi said, and to give those in the audience a little bit of a broader context, I'm a former Republican member of Congress. Gigi is a great advocate for consumers, public interest, and now at the FCC, a loyal and faithful Democrat. Net neutrality historically has been a bipartisan national consensus that started in the FCC of Michael Powell as a policy statement of principles. Then Kevin Martin, another Republican commissioner, tried to enforce those principles. And that's the first step of getting us where we are today, where the current chairman has to give the strongest, most sustainable legal rules possible so that they won't be overturned. But Comcast challenged a Republican commission authority to be able to enforce net neutrality principles. You then had, in 2010, Chairman Jenkowski, with a broad national consensus of almost every internet public interest and incumbent provider, agreed to these sets of rules, except Verizon. Verizon challenged it. The court struck down most of the rules, but not all. And so today we're where we are because of Comcast and Verizon. It was not something that this chair or commission wanted to do, but left with no choice but to have the strongest possible, most sustainable rules. And I really commend the chairman. He did it in a light touch, flexible way that's based off the wireless model. And it came through a Republican act of Congress, 1996, that allows him to use the most light touch, flexible way of doing these rules in a legally sustainable manner.
How many of you live in DC? How many of you like work in technology and build things or mark? Okay. So you should probably know that the net neutrality decision a few weeks ago was pretty epic, amazing, and completely unexpected. There's a huge disconnect between Washington, D.C. and the rest of the country. Right? It's like the Hunger Games, where there's the capital and then the districts. And a year ago...
And Marvin organized the insurgents.
It all began at South by Southwest a year ago, actually. So if you live in D.C., you know, you're just surrounded by telecom lobbyists. There are more of them than there are Starbucks or McDonald's, just everywhere. You can't even like hire a law firm that isn't conflicted. And there's just this feeling that like no one cared about net neutrality. And when you come out to like the public, you guys, I remember last year at South By, everyone was like, oh, net neutrality is so important, how do we help? And this is really the community that I think led the way. And what happened a few weeks ago was very simple rules saying, if you didn't follow closely, no blocking. You know, Comcast, AT&T, Verizon can't block websites. They can't discriminate and treat some better than others, creating fast lanes and slow lanes. You know, if you have a startup, there's no way you could afford a fast lane competing with Google or Facebook or eBay. And then no paid prioritization, no deals, where in order to compete with a big guy, you got to cut a deal with Comcast and Verizon and Deutsche Telekom next. Just the internet will stay open and neutral. And had you guys not spoken up, had we not won, we were barreling towards a future where there would have been a decision December 18th, where the FCC's proposal would have been constrained by the carriers and permitted fast lanes, permitted all this terrible stuff. And right now you'd be spending your entire South by trying to make deals with Verizon Ventures and Comcast Ventures so that your businesses would be able to grow. And we averted that, and it was largely because of this community.
So. Okay, everybody else is saying something, so I feel like I gotta say something too. Except for James, I guess you're next. I have a totally different perspective than everybody else on the panel. So I'm with Data Foundry, we're an operator. So we look at this sort of as a black box. You know, things happen out there, and I don't always know what's happening on the inside or how it's happening. These guys, they know how the sausage is being made, and I don't know how the sausage is being made. All I see are what's happening to us in the real world. So, frankly, I'm a little superstitious, and I see patterns, and I expect whatever patterns I've seen in the past are going to continue in the future, regardless of how I know how they happen. And I'll tell you, from my operator experience, the dark triad, you were asking who's going to sue. Well, the dark triad is Comcast, Verizon, and AT&T. In all of my years as an operator, those are the three who have consistently always been a major problem, I finally got some of the economic terms to understand, is rent seeking. What they want to do is they want to lock up this monopoly of their end users, and they want to collect whatever tax, whatever rent, in the economic terms rent, they can get off of everybody else in the world who wants to do any traffic or transaction with all of these eyeballs they have locked up on their network. So the short answer to the question is, who's going to sue? Well, if it's not Comcast, AT&T, and Verizon, because maybe they're thinking they're too slick and they're not going to come at it head on, maybe it's a trade group that they control. I'm sorry? Comcast has a lot on their plate in D.C. right now. Good. Pile more on their damn plate. I have no sympathy for those guys. Anyway, I think you can tell. So that's my perspective. So that's what I'd say is to watch out. If there's some sort of legal action that comes, and it comes for some group that's called, you know, Freedom for Internet Fighters, go look in who's funding them. And oh my gosh, is it Verizon funding them? No kidding. That's the cynic and the superstitious guy in me who's saying that, from my experience in operating, that's what I expect to see. Now, hopefully, I mean, I'm feeling better and better about it every day, that we'll beat them off, but you know, we'll see how it goes.
Maybe we can carry on the audience participation that Marvin started. So we know who lives in DC, and we know who works in technology. Who's not from the US? Not very many. I thought this was a pretty international festival. Well, you'll all appreciate the two hands that came up, but even those who are from the US will still appreciate this, that the news gets better. So Marvin said that a year ago it was almost inconceivable that we'd get the rules that we've got in the United States. Well, 2 years ago, when we started working on it in Brussels, where I live and work, in the European legislative process, it was inconceivable that we would get pro-net neutrality law. And while we haven't quite finished yet, it'll be finished before this summer, we will get pro-net neutrality law across the whole of the European Union as well. So we're going to go from having 330 million people covered by net neutrality to close to a billion, because that'll be another 500 million people covered. So that's a pretty good, almost 50% of the world's economy covered by net neutrality rules, and I'd say that's pretty important. I don't think you should be so pessimistic, Rob. I mean, maybe people will sue, but I think you should have started on a more optimistic note. This is good news.
What death, taxes, and litigation are always with us.
But I want to pick up on what James said and also what Marvin said, because you did start on a down note, and it is amazing that 4 million people weighed into the FCC. I mean, this was a public-driven process. I mean, I was walking here. I was a little late because this guy stopped me. He recognized me, and he said, "My God, for once, democracy worked." And I've heard that from an awful lot of people. People are really cynical. People are super cynical about what happens in Washington. I'm pretty cynical myself, but this was a case where the big dogs were going to win, and the public just got outraged. And a lot of things are driving that, okay? People are concerned about consolidation. They think their broadband is slow, they think they pay too much, and they're sick of it. And I think a lot of that had to do with them participating in this net neutrality thing. So everybody should give themselves a round of applause, because you guys really did this. This was a public uprising. But let me also say this, okay? It's just started. I know you hate to hear that. You know, you've been working your asses off for 13, 14 months, and you got a great result. But it's not over, okay? The same companies that are going to sue are going to try to use other means to take this victory away from you. So the same groups, and I know a lot of them around here, Fight for the Future and EFF and others, they're going to ask you to weigh in again. And we're going to need you to weigh in again and again and again. So sorry, party tonight, but then get back to work tomorrow.
Can I add to that note? Fight for the Future will add you to, will ask you to weigh in. So will Demand Progress. So will EFF. But there were a lot of interesting moments where nobody asked for someone to do something, and out of the blue, it happened. I mean, I can give one example where, you know, I knew an entrepreneur in San Francisco. It was probably April or May, and he emailed me and said, "We've got to get John Oliver talking about this." And I was like, "Why John Oliver? He's just on HBO. No one watches HBO. He had this new show. Wasn't all that popular." I was like, "Look, dude, you're this like relentless entrepreneur who knows people in Hollywood or New York. Just email everyone you know. Do whatever you want, and then you know we'll see what happens." And a few weeks later, there was, you know, this John Oliver skit that was amazing. And there were other moments like that when, you know, we didn't just sort of organically, someone came up with some meme or, you know, plugged in or was doing meetings we didn't know about. And so people like you are the folks where you don't need to be told what to do, although we'll tell you when we need help. But, you know, you guys can do things on your own. And it was amazing.
So looking ahead, how many alleged violations do you think we're going to see over the next year? How many cases will actually come up of companies trying to get around these rules?
I think very few, right? This is under litigation. People are going to be on their best behavior. And the fact of the matter was, when the 2010 rules were in place for almost 4 years, there were very few violations or allegations of violations. What did happen was we got dozens of complaints that had to do with interconnection, right? So people's Netflix was loading slowly, and Netflix was fighting with both Comcast and Verizon Fios, and that's one of the reasons why our new rules now include traffic exchange between networks, because that turned out to be the problem. But I anticipate that, particularly given that this, you know, look, if we lose, which I do not believe we will, we could be at this again, that everybody's going to be on their best behavior. So I'm sure there'll be some allegations and informal complaints, but I think the companies are really not going to test, not going to push the envelope. Now, they may on some of the things that we didn't flat out ban, right? So things like zero rating, sponsored data, we didn't flat out ban those. We said that you can bring a complaint. So there may be some testing, but I think that companies are going to be pretty mellow and not try to push the envelope too much.
Rob, I was just going to agree with Gigi. I don't think on the bright line rules of no paid prioritization, blocking, throttling, those types of clear rules, I don't think that you'll see many abuses or problems. And one reason that they'll be on their best behavior is that they have mergers before the FCC as well. So whether it's Comcast, Time Warner, AT&T, Direct. So all of those reasons will have a deterrent effect. But I do want to commend the FCC for extending the FCC authority to the point of interconnection. As Gigi just talked about, the battle has just begun. But many of the battles are going from the end user last mile to now the point of interconnection. And so the John Oliver skit, the buffering that you might see that go round and round, and as you're trying to either, So if you're trying to access Comcast, it goes directly, and if you're trying to get your Netflix, it is very slow. Well, that's a perfect example of what both the rules on the end user, last mile, and the point of interconnection is intended to have a open, free, competitive market. And the interconnection issues will be the next battlefield, I think, of making sure that we do have over-the-top streaming all options, both in the business market and the residential market, and not have a bottleneck gatekeeper at the point of interconnection that would be a barrier to many of the things that we want as we access the internet.
And let me sort of flip that question around. Had the FCC, had we history taken a different course, how many of these offenses would we be complaining about and complaining that the FCC couldn't do anything about if the regulations that were on the table a year ago were the ones we wound up with?
So maybe 3 days after the Verizon decision last January, when the FCC's previous net neutrality rules were thrown out. So there were about 3 days that passed without any net neutrality rules. And one of my friends, who's a lawyer for a San Francisco tech company, called me and let me know that they'd already gotten an outreach from a big telecom company with a new innovative pricing plan that they were just, you know, wanted to discuss with them. So they were ready to pounce on the idea of being able to cut deals with some tech companies versus others to sort of move higher up the stack. So I think there would be a lot, there would be no complaints because there'd be no rules, but there would have been a lot of violations. And what the carriers kind of want to do is just find a little loophole. Like, oh, we'll try to figure out a way to throttle Netflix within this part of the network, not that part of the network, and hope that it's legal. Or we won't create fast lanes or slow lanes, but we'll sell you a bucket of data, and then we'll let some of the data not count. We'll have, you know, I don't know, Facebook or someone pay us to be exempt from the data cap, or like Netflix. So like 20 days into your month, all of a sudden, YouTube will cost you money, but you can stream Netflix for free. Huge advantage for whoever gets those deals. And AT&T is introducing some of them, has a sponsored data idea, which was an outright ban. And so when Gigi says there might not be any complaints because there might not be any violations, there's still some stuff going out there about interconnection and this sort of bandwidth discrimination. And it's possible that the consumer groups decide to just file a complaint and bring the fight right to the carriers and get this taken care of sooner rather than later.
So let me tell you what would have happened if we'd not had rules. So when Verizon challenged the 2010 rules, their lawyer got up in open court and basically said, in response to a question from one of the judges, if these rules were not in place, yes, we would strike these paid prioritization deals. They basically flat out said it. So I think you absolutely would have seen paid for priority fast lanes. And fast lanes, now many, many, many people who weighed in at the FCC, millions, said we want Title II reclassification, which was just startling to me. Because I expected a lot of people to say we want strong net neutrality rules, but to ask for the thing was amazing. But even those folks that didn't ask for Title II reclassification, they said no fast lanes. That was the thing that was just, people were united around. And that would have been the thing, in my mind, that the ISPs absolutely would have engaged in had we not had rules.
So from my perspective, when we talk about fast lanes, it sounds like a nice thing, right? It's a shakedown. I think I'm almost afraid that fast lane kind of whitewashes what they actually want to do. It's a shakedown. It's the difference between the fast lane and the slow lane will be the difference between functioning and not functioning. It's not the fast lane and the regular lane. It's the, oh, you want it to work or you know, or what? So I just want to say that.
Now we switch to a different mic. The advantage is I can end this debate by dropping the mic. At heart, this is a discussion not just about potential abuses and regulation, but competition. And in one respect, the net neutrality rules, there were a number of people who wanted them to be stronger and require things like unbundling, requiring broadband providers to wholesale their connections so other people could offer service over those, which is a commonplace thing in wireless, but unthinkable in residential broadband. The FCC took that off the table. There's no unbundling, no line sharing like there was with DSL. What can and should the FCC do to boost competition? We know there's the municipal broadband policy to try to overturn state bans, and that we'll get to that in a second. What else is in the toolkit to try to address that?
I guess I'm answering that question. Yes, so importantly, one of the Title II rules, so just to explain, what we did when we reclassified broadband internet access as a telecommunications provider, as telecommunications service under Title II of the Communications Act, was at the same time we said, look, Title II has a lot of sections that don't really shouldn't apply in a broadband world. And this is similar to how mobile voice has been regulated for over 20 years. Okay, we don't apply all of Title II because some of the provisions are just not applicable or not in the public interest. So we did the same thing here. So one of the sections, Section 224 of the Communications Act that we did apply, we did not forbear from, requires competitors to get fair access to poles and to conduit. And this is something that Google Fiber very much wants and has had trouble where it's wanted to build out. So we think that that's not the be-all, end-all. It's not, you know, like community broadband. It's not the panacea to competition, but it will certainly help competitors compete. The other place where we want to do a better job of incenting competition is in our spectrum policy. So we've set aside a lot of unlicensed spectrum. So that is spectrum that nobody has a license to and that anybody can build to as long as they share. In addition, we've got a huge spectrum auction coming up. I don't want to explain all the details, but our rules would limit the amount of spectrum any one company can own. So we're trying through spectrum policy, through what we've done in the net neutrality rules and through community broadband, but we need more ideas for how to incent facilities-based competition.
You know, Rob, just to give a perfect example of what we need, you look no further than Austin, where you have Google Fiber that has entered, and what has happened, and this is a great example of what happens to investment when you have competition. Time Warner responded, AT&T is building, others are building fiber in Austin, and now you're getting multiple networks. And wherever our nation has adopted a policy that has spurred multiple networks, first in long distance, then in wireless, bringing satellite to compete against cable, it always caused new networks, more networks, multiple options, and a functioning market versus a monopoly or duopoly market. And so if we can have what we have in Austin, everywhere around the country, that solves a lot of the issues that we have around open internet or any of the other contentious regulatory issues, because the market begins to function and work.
Let me give a different perspective. I'm not going to try and preach exactly what the FCC should do, because you're all more familiar with the situation here. But one thing that strikes me linking the open internet net neutrality debate with telecoms competition is the analogy of going to the doctor. So if anyone here is ill and you go and see your doctor, the doctor's probably going to do two things at the same time. They're going to try and understand what the disease is, what the problem is, and how they're going to cure that. And they're probably going to treat the symptoms as well. They're probably going to give you something to make you feel better before you've been treated for that disease. And that's a little bit the question here with competition in telecoms and what you as a business or as a consumer can do, what you can get to. Open internet rules are important treating the symptom of the lack of competition. So the more facilities-based competition you can have, or sometimes not facilities-based competition, so something like a special access regime or a wholesale regime, the better, the more choices you've got in terms of who you're going to go to get your broadband access. That's an extremely important part.
So I'll sound a slightly different note, which is, or similar to that, which is we need net neutrality. We need rules that say no blocking, no fast lanes, no discrimination, no throttling. And we also need competition in broadband. We need both. And the reason why is because there's sort of complicated economics around the fact that, you know, even if you can choose your ISP on day one, once you've chosen Comcast, the only way for Netflix to get to you is through Comcast. Yeah. You have a year-long contract. You're not going to switch to Verizon just midstream to try to get Netflix. You don't get two different subscriptions. And there are lots of things competition solves, but we don't take away fuel efficiency rules just because car companies compete with one another. You don't take away non-blocking rules just because you have a few phone companies competing. In some European countries, despite competition among mobile carriers, all of them were blocking Skype. So you just have to make sure you have both the belt and the suspenders. And an argument that seemed to be pretty common in DC was from AT&T and Verizon and Comcast was, just deregulate us and let us make a ton of money, you know, gouging consumers, and then we'll take it and we'll reinvest it. And we'll provide this awesome broadband experience. You just let us gouge consumers. And it turns out that never works. Instead, competition works. Google shows up and all of a sudden AT&T is like, we're gonna do that too. Time Warner says we're gonna do that too. Competition is how you get high speeds, low prices, better customer service, maybe. And so I think that's a lesson that DC should learn.
So,
you were saying.
Yeah, I just want to illustrate this. So unbundling, right? I love unbundling.
Explain it to people.
Yeah, right. So unbundling, what is that? Well, gosh. Unbundling, I think Gigi really said it, access to poles and conduit so that a new entrant can come in behind the existing incumbents and more cheaply build out to the same areas. But you know, unbundling is a step in the right direction. I'd love to see it further. I just want to, this is my favorite prop. I've got Boardwatch magazine. Everybody in the audience who's ever read a Boardwatch magazine, please raise your hand. All right. Everybody buy those people drinks because they're the gray beers and get them talking about the old days. So we started Texas.net dial-up ISP in 1994. We were one of the first in the country. Ron, Carolyn, visionaries on what the future was going to be. I told my parents, I got out of college, I said, I'm going to go work for an ISP. They said, what? So in 1997, I've got a Boardwatch magazine here, and it lists every single ISP that you could go connect to in the country. They broke them down by area code with advertisements and independent testing and maps. And then area code 512, which was the second market we launched in San Antonio, and we came to Austin shortly in 95. We came to Austin. In 1997, the 512 area code had 50 ISPs that you could choose from. When they talk about competition now, people are like, oh yeah, let's have three, maybe four. Like, come on. How many choices do you have for jelly?
Brisket.
Why? I mean, it's like, well, you know, I want, you know, the Google ISP. Yeah, okay, great. I mean, it's like, It's a feudalism. What we have now is sort of a feudalistic thing where you pledge your allegiance to one feudal overlord, and this one feudal overlord will protect you and go to battle for you against another feudal overlord. And we're just the peons down, and the monsters are fighting, the big giants are fighting each other. It's like, come on. What about us? So... Anyway.
I do remember the days of line sharing. I used a DSL provider called Speakeasy Network, which is based in Seattle.
Yes.
They resold Verizon's copper. They had great service at the time when Verizon's DSL was kind of a real hairball from what we just told me. And all those independent DSL providers kind of went away.
Yeah.
Because the FCC gutted the unbundling requirements in 2005, right?
For DSL, 2005.
Yes. So anyways, moving forward, I mentioned municipal broadband. The FCC just voted to overturn regulations hindering that in North Carolina and Tennessee. Are those, another downer question for me, is that actually going to stand up in court as well? Because I'm pretty sure we have some disagreement between someone sitting next to me and someone sitting 10 feet that way.
So look, we've put forth our strongest argument, all right? So what we've done, just to step back a minute... is we got a petition from the Electronic Power Board of Chattanooga, Tennessee, which built the country's first gigabit network, and also a petition from the city of Wilson, North Carolina. And they are not, because of restrictions in their state laws, they're not allowed to expand beyond their footprint. And there was a woman who came, so we voted on these preemptions the same day that we voted on net neutrality. And there was a guy from Tennessee who came, and the chairman made him stand up and told the story. His name was Richard Thornton. He lives 3/4 of a mile from where EPB, the Electronic Power Board, is allowed to provide service. He pays $316 a month for a combination of mobile hotspots, satellite service, and TV. If he lived 3/4 of a mile closer, he'd pay $133 a month. Right? So, I mean, it's an amazing story and not the only one. But the fact of the matter is, we've made the best argument we can make. There is some Supreme Court precedent that's not friendly to us, but we think our argument is sustainable. But let me say this, with no disrespect to the lawyers at the FCC, I think we have a very good chance of winning. Even if we don't win, what we've done is if we've raised this issue to a national platform, and we're already starting to see activity catalyzed in places where they have restrictions and where they don't have restrictions. So, for example, Connecticut, the state of Connecticut put out an RFP for request for proposals to build a gigabit network throughout the state. And 100 of 169 towns are interested. So people believe that community broadband is an idea whose time has come. They're sick and tired of monopoly and duopoly, and they want to build their own, and they want to decide what kind of, you know, network, what kind of broadband competition they want. Now, regardless of, you know, the court case is going to take time, but we've already had people from three other states come to us asking us whether they should file a petition. So if we do win, I do expect there to be a steady stream of petitions from other states asking us to preempt. Now, we've got to judge them on the facts, all right? All the laws are different, but trust me, Texas is one place. The City Council of San Antonio, I met with about three or four of the City Council members. They are chomping at the bit to build community broadband. And they, you know, I think they may be one of the states knocking at the door if we succeed.
And just sort of big picture, right? There are cities that want to do municipal, city-owned, fiber, high-speed internet. And what happened is companies like Verizon, the unholy triad of Comcast, Verizon, and AT&T went to the state level in, I don't know how many states, 20-something?
19 states.
Texas included.
And just said, passed state-level laws saying you cities can't build these networks, or you need permission, or all these different limitations. And then the FCC went one level higher and preempted the state laws to then permit some of the cities to do good stuff. And so they did it the same day as the net neutrality order. Had they done it any other day, it would have been major national news and an amazing shock that, like, wow, the FCC did something amazing for consumers. And it was kind of unnoticed because of the importance of the net neutrality order. But, you know,
it was kind of on purpose.
Yeah, well.
If you're going to do two controversial things, you know, try to bury one, right?
Anyway, thank you, FCC. Nice work.
You know, I'm curious about is a judicial challenge the bigger danger, or a legislative challenge a bigger danger? And really, I'm curious if Chip has a perspective on that.
So the question is the legislative challenge or the judicial challenge?
Yes. Yeah, which one is bigger? Well, and you mean for open internet or municipal fiber?
I mean for the municipal fiber.
Okay.
You mean in Congress?
Give you a little bit of history. I got to work on, as a Senate staffer, the 1996 Telecom Act, which ended all monopolies, created competitive internet connection, and it really laid the groundwork for what we've seen in the wireless and other competitive options that we do have over the last 20 years. And so as Congress looks at a possible rewrite, and they're beginning to discuss that, around the country, you've had these different state legislative bodies that have preempted municipal entry. It really does get back to the question, how do we solve the last mile lack of competition? How do we go from a scarcity of last mile broadband, wired and wireless, to an abundance? We now have something that we haven't had in the last 20 years. Broadband internet service is an economic driver that whether you're in Austin, Texas, or in Laurel, Mississippi, or small town South Dakota, a co-op, a municipality, a small cable company, a Kansas regional fiber company, they're wanting to go out and deploy fiber networks last mile to the home and to the business, and that is a new good development. If we remove barriers, share the infrastructure, have continuing competition policy and last mile special access and open internet, we can have an abundant supply of broadband versus the scarcity that happens when you allow monopolies and duopolies to dominate.
Let's turn our attention to interconnection. That's kind of the vaguest part of the open internet rules, where the FCC basically says, we realize this is an issue. I remember Chairman Wheeler at this event last January saying that his wife was complaining about Netflix performance, saying, you're the chairman of the FCC. Will you please do something about this? How is this going to play out? I mean, it seems like the FCC has a lot of power to ask pointed questions. On the other hand, I guess some of the worst cases have been resolved by checks are getting cut, money's getting transferred one way or another. Is this a problem that gets solved in any meaningful way over the next year?
I don't think it gets resolved. What's critical here is for the very... The marching band ended and now I got this.
We're all kryptonite to microphones tonight.
The fact of the matter is, for the very first time, the FCC has the authority to entertain complaints if Netflix and Verizon, or Netflix and Comcast, or Cogent and Comcast have a battle over this. And that wasn't the case before. As I said before, you know, when I first got to the FCC, I would see informal net neutrality-like complaints come in every week, and they were almost all about Netflix taking too long to buffer. So I do suspect that if the ISPs try to extract a lot of money for interconnection, or if they, you know, if they congest their ports, if they send the, you know, Netflix traffic to congested ports, or, you know, level three traffic to congested ports, I think we will see a complaint. I mean, that may be one of the exceptions to the we won't see complaints, because we've decided not to apply the bright line rules to interconnection for a number of reasons, but we do say that the Title II prohibition against unjust and unreasonable practices, rates, terms, and conditions does apply, and you can file a complaint. But again, this is, I don't want to call it radical, but it's something that the FCC has never asserted jurisdiction over before, so it's a really big deal.
And let me also just say that a year ago, no one thought that it would be possible to have interconnection included in the open internet rule. And so we've made tremendous progress, and the commission showed clear courage in being able to address this and include it in the order. And I do think it solves not only the present but long-term problems, and it gives us a process, a standard, and a way to make sure that the market continues to function and that and the interconnection as well as the last mile remains open.
And Gigi, just following up on your point, I'm interested to know how easy it'll be it would potentially be to find some kind of abuse and to know whether it's abusive. And one of the reasons I ask this is we've actually had a kind of an action already in Europe where the European competition authorities did a raid about a year and a half ago. They put on their balaclavas and go and see companies at about 7 o'clock in the morning when they're not expecting it. And they went to raid the offices of three major telecoms firms on exactly this issue to do with IP interconnection. And a year later they came back and said, we're not pursuing a case. And they haven't been extremely clear about what they didn't find. But I wonder whether you think it'll be an easy thing to do.
Can you imagine if the FCC did that? Oh, my God.
Yeah. It's fun. I understand it's fun.
I can't even imagine a jackbooted FCC enforcement.
Could it involve black helicopters?
Horrible.
We need black helicopters here.
I think we would prefer evidentiary presentations by the parties. Look, the Open Technology Institute, the New America Foundation, actually has done quite a bit of study on these interconnection issues and came to a number of conclusions. We actually still have an open proceeding looking at the Netflix congestion both on Comcast and Verizon networks. But I think we'll stick with lawyers submitting pleadings and we'll get away from the balaclava raids.
So I want to talk about interconnection a little bit, again, from the operator's perspective, which is very different from the policymaker's perspective. We've been... I'm a Data Foundry sister company, GigaNews, Usenet News Groups. I spent a lot of time working the GigaNews networks, and we had a lot of traffic flowing to consumer ISPs. And we were engaged mano-a-mano with the tactics that the major last-mile ISPs were using to try to shake us down to pay them to seek rent from us to deliver traffic to their customers. And what they do, the tactics are very well known in the operators community, where they will winnow down the number of connections that they have that you can reach them through a third party. And the few that they have that let you connect to them from a third party, they will slowly let them fill up until maybe there's one port over here that's not congested. And if you can get your traffic to route that way, then you're doing great, but you can't count on that. And then that port fills up and another port opens up. And then now your traffic's going through the congested port. You got to reroute it through the uncongested port. And you're playing whack-a-mole with them. And you reach out and say, can y'all fix this peering that you have so we have a place to send the traffic to? And they say, well, why don't you just, you know, here, let me give you a proposal. We'll give you a port. Just pay us. We'll give you a port that's not congested. And this is really similar, I think, to the fast lane, slow lane, which is why I'm really sensitive to the fast lane thing, because they've done it before just with straight ports. And now, you know, they'd be throwing me in the briar patch. Okay, we'll do fast lanes, you know, and make it sound like it's some benefit to you because it's fast.
You know, it's like the lines at South by Southwest, actually. So if you have like the VIP line, if you pay, and then the people who don't pay. So, I mean, what they've done is they've congested all the connections into the big networks, pretty much, or a lot of them. So the traffic being sent that isn't paid doesn't work, it's congested. And so when they were trying to shake down Netflix, they, you know, put Netflix in the back of the line and said, you know, come pay for a VIP. What they ended up doing was they harmed all the other traffic on the network that Netflix was using. So if Netflix was going through, you know, a network known as Level 3 or a network known as Cogent, a million other sites were also going through that network, like hospitals, you know, you name it. And if you go into, if you have a researcher named Adam Lin, who just goes into these like chat rooms and figures out who's complaining, not only to the FCC, but trying to figure out what's going on, there were tons of different businesses that had been the collateral damage of Comcast trying to shake down Netflix for a few extra bucks. So if you let them create a fast lane or to charge, they're just, all it does is create a slow lane that's totally unusable or very unusable. And so even if you're at home paying 50 megabits a second from Comcast, you're like, gee, how come Netflix only loads at 1 megabit per second? It's because they hadn't paid yet. And so they're sort of pinching the straw on the other end. So it's a huge problem, and I could imagine, action.
But I should confess, I came in through the VIP door. It was shorter line that way. One other question before we turn this over to you all. How does this play out next year in the election? That this seems to have become a partisan issue where it really wasn't for a long time. I know what you think. I know what you first, Chip.
You know, as a Republican, it grieves me to see most of my party align more with the incumbents, which is really as a free market type person, I look at the incumbents who simply want to have their markets and their old business models protected. And instead of having free market competition that is disruptive, the open internet, if you think about it, if we were to go to bed tonight and have a dream of a perfect free market, the internet is a perfect free market. You know, the democracy that Gigi talked about, as far as being able to have 4 million people actually have an influence on something that was technical, it seemed, and regulatory and Washington-based, that is an example of the free expression and the power of an open free network and platform. So as we go forward, what I'm beginning to see and what I sense and believe is the internet economy and the internet value system, the internet principles, are going to overtake the old networks and the old models, and it's going to reshape politics on both sides of the aisle, and eventually the Republicans will go from being a traditionalist, institutionalist status quo, protecting of the old models and the old ways, to joining the new way, the new economy, new principles. And it's just going to take us persuading, engaging, informing, getting Data Foundry to bring Republicans down to see their wonderful facility in Austin that is, talk about investment and innovation. It is the hub of the internet, probably one of the best facilities you could ever have any place in the world that we got to tour today with Gigi and the rest of the team here. Those types of things and efforts will eventually bring the entire country, both parties, into a consensus.
I'd just like to give a shout out to Data Foundry and to Ron and to Andy and to Ed.
Yeah.
Because they do God's work. I mean, I love, Andy says to me, oh, I had lunch with Grover Norquist today and we just couldn't convince him and we got up on a stage with Ted Cruz. God bless you guys. I may be a Democrat, though not quite as hard line as Chip would like to make me out to be. But the fact of the matter is it gives me no joy that this has become a partisan issue. Okay, so the first time the internet rose up and affected policy was the SOPA-PIPA battle. So that the SOPA-PIPA were two very bad laws that Hollywood proposed that really would have broken the internet just to protect their copyright. And this was bipartisan. In fact, the Republicans had to drag the Democrats, right? It was people
True.
Like Daryl Issa and folks like that, Jerry Moran from Kansas and others, who said, this is bad, and the Democrats finally got a clue, all right? But that's what we'd really like to see. And we do have, we don't only have folks like Chip, there's a group called the Internet Freedom Business Alliance, which includes a lot of conservative groups. But we cannot yet seem to get a policymaker in Washington to say that net neutrality, and particularly Title II, is important. And I don't know if people saw what happened when Ted Cruz called net neutrality Obamacare for the internet. He got excoriated. He got scorched on his Facebook page. And that kind of, these folks need to know that their constituents want an open internet, that that's really important to them. And again, God bless Data Foundry, and Scott McCullough is also there. I love listening to him talk.
So
he sounds like a good old liberal when he talks, but he ain't. And those guys are at the bleeding edge, and I believe that one day you guys will be vindicated because your party will come around. Because otherwise, it's going to be bad for them in elections going forward.
I'm sure some of you noticed Grumpy Cat flying over the skies, taunting Ted Cruz for his wrong position on net neutrality a few days ago. That was Fight for the Future and Demand Progress. So one thing that shocked DC was that people were calling them about this issue, right? Tumblr, Etsy, Kickstarter, Vimeo, these activist groups drove hundreds of thousands of calls. Now, usually they get calls and it's mess with my Medicare, don't mess with my Social Security. Maybe there are calls about pipelines or immigration, guns. I mean, I think there's a generational shift happening, and people who are born and raised with the internet, this is open data to connect with anyone, to them, taking away an open internet is like taking away, for the previous generations, Social Security or Medicare. Just, this is something we as Americans, or free expression, right, these are our privacy, right? Like an open internet is so core to what we believe that people pick up the phone and call congressmen, call the FCC, they take action, and that is transformational. And I think any presidential candidate or party who's on the wrong side of history will have to switch or die.
So I just want to say, Andrew McFarlane and Andrew Staples and some other folks in Golden Frog worked really hard to pull this panel together. You may have noticed that we're all kind of agreeing up here. We didn't plan to have everybody on the panel agreeing, but all the people who think the other way, who disagree, they wouldn't come. They were invited. That's not true. Okay, I guess we had one and didn't make the cut. Maybe we'll talk more about that one later. But seriously, Andy McFarlane spends a lot of time on both sides of the aisle. He gets incredulous looks and people giving that kind of nervous laugh at him. when he goes from one side of the aisle to the other and says, oh, I just talked to the guy over there. And they say, really? You talked to him? Isn't he a Neanderthal? But he talks to everybody, and we work with everybody. And Andy tried to get dissenting voices on this panel, example notwithstanding, and we couldn't get somebody to come up here and disagree and fight with us. So my point is that there is a sea change happening, and we are on the right side of history, and you stand in front of it at your own peril.
So let's, on that note, perhaps some of you have questions of your own. Do we have a microphone floating around, or do y'all just need to? All right, good. Just come up, maybe? Please, yes. And there may be a question or two from Twitter that we have coming our way. All right.
I was actually really interested in the answer to. I don't feel like I got an answer very well. What's the bigger challenge, the judicial side of the fight or the legislative side of the fight?
Of which fight?
For open internet?
Yeah, for the open. Because I mean, you said that this is not the last battle. We're going to have to keep fighting, have to keep showing up. But yeah, is it going to be on the judicial side or the legislative side?
So, I can try. So, the FCC has lost twice in court already, when they didn't use their strongest authority, known as Title II. They were kind of using scraps of authority, and all along we knew that if they used Title II, they would win. I actually had the honor and discomfort of arguing the first case we lost alongside the FCC General Counsel. I mean, it was a blowout. We had our head handed to us, and we knew we had to go to Title II. Now that we have Title II, I think we're going to win. And there isn't really much of a role for you guys, unless I can figure out a way, or one of us can figure out a way, to have you guys file an amicus brief, like 10 million people strong. That'd be fun.
It wouldn't be a bad idea. It's not impossible, yeah. Right? I mean, you could do that, and it would have a lot of meaning.
But when it comes to Congress, those people are elected. They care about what their voters think, what their constituents think. And Congress and the carriers have all these lobbyists. I mean, they spend more money than, like, the oil companies or big pharma or defense contractors. D.C. is crawling with these guys, you know, giving the opposite view, trying to get Congress to reverse what the FCC did. That's where you guys can have the biggest impact, and that's probably where we're most vulnerable. So I think everyone would probably agree, but...
There are two risk variables here. You have the legal risk, and by using Title II, I believe that you really reduce the legal risk of what the FCC just adopted. But in doing the strongest possible rules, you get the strongest possible backlash from the other side. And so you've increased the political risk. So the engagement that everybody used so effectively with the FCC now needs to go to the members of Congress, Republican and Democrat, to do exactly what you did at the FCC, but with the other institution, the legislative branch, because Tom Wheeler, the chairman, is about to go through 2 weeks of hearings before Congress over the next 2 weeks. The support that you can provide him will have a very strong impression. Everyone remembers SOPA PIPA, and that was a very effective outpouring of public will and sentiment. There'll be a possible 1996 reform of the telecom laws also before Congress. And you could have open internet as part of that legislative process. So this ongoing battle, which I believe that we will eventually prevail both legislatively, politically, legally, and on the regulatory side, but we're in the last stages and the last battles of this decade-long war. But the merits are on our side. The public is on our side, and that will be reflected. You know, Congress is like a market as well. The marketplace is shifting, the values are shifting, and Congress will begin to reflect that. And as y'all stay engaged, I believe that we will prevail on this policy in both branches and in any venue.
Who's next? Cool. Thank you.
Hi, my name is Mike. I just want to thank you for being here, and I hope you don't mind me asking a question that kind of reaches beyond U.S. policy. I was reviewing some recent, a casual survey on residents in Thailand, and more of them use Facebook than access the internet. That's their perception of what these resources are. And so I'm thinking, you know, considering what many companies, many U.S. companies are pursuing with this whole emerging market and third world nations, is there a response to this of people whose perception of what these resources are solely through a corporation and not of what this, you know, what we perceive as to be the World Wide Web or other internet resources?
Shall I have a go? I think it depends on the country and what, how much bandwidth there is, what kind of computing devices people have. If they have something that's very low powered, you can have a very different situation from someone who's got several computing devices, like probably everyone in this room. Not quite an answer to your question, but linking your question and the discussion we've just been having. When I'm talking about this subject elsewhere in the world, I normally talk first about the open internet, but second about the open global internet. Because it may or may not be particularly aware of the fact that there's a number of places around the world where people would like to fragment the way the internet works. And that could be because of industrial reasons, it can be often because of government control. Particularly some of the more autocratic regimes around the world would like to see compulsory local storage of data, for example, because they want to be able to inspect that data and find out what you're up to. So a second part of this fight is not only having an open internet where we live in the United States or in Europe, but also having a global internet, because that's how we ensure that people have maximum access to information, not just in terms of which websites they're going to, but in terms of having opportunities beyond their national borders.
So I can answer the question directly. Also, if any of you want to get involved, just email me, marvinamori@gmail.com. Find me at Twitter, @amori. We'll figure out a way to plug you in. So what's happening around the world is there are some countries, usually generally very poor countries with very low connectivity, and people don't realize why they should use the internet. And some companies like Wikipedia and Facebook have these partnerships in these countries where they say, you know, because bandwidth is so expensive, what we're going to do is cut deals with phone companies so that Facebook and Wikipedia, et cetera, don't count against any bandwidth cap. So if you're a poor person in one of these countries, you think the internet is Facebook because that's what's free for you when you pay the monthly fee. And there are lots of different ways to think about this exemption to the bandwidth cap. And there are probably three categories. Right? One category is where there's an exemption and no fee paid by Wikipedia or Facebook to the phone companies. Right?
Sort of also like T-Mobile's Music Freedom.
In the U.S., we have T-Mobile's Music Freedom. Now, if there was a payment from Wikipedia to these carriers, that would cause all of the fast lane, slow lane problems. You'd keep the bandwidth, you know, cap really low, and then you just start extracting money from big companies to jump over, right? Really big problem. So I think that should actually have been banned by the FCC. I think that's an easier case. And I think where the carriers try to do that, especially in the US where, you know, we have a more robust market, we're not a third world country, right? I think that should have been banned. But then there are other situations where they do it without a fee. And if you look at the Wikipedia model, it's only in really poor countries. There's no fee, it's non-exclusive in both directions. And you can debate what's better and what's worse, but what the carriers really want are exclusive deals where they auction off exclusivity. And in countries that have this kind of exemption from data caps, you have far lower data caps, much lower. And when they ban it, the data caps get doubled, like in the Netherlands. And I believe 7 countries that have net neutrality have banned these kind of zero rating deals under certain situations. And so I think it's a problem, but I do see why it could be different how Wikipedia does it in certain third world countries. But that's sort of that's what you're asking. It's a very good question.
Who's next?
Hey, my name is Andre. I had a question about the FCC, really, and how this problem's been kind of set up by media consolidation and the lack of enforcing some of the rules that have been in existence for years, that just kind of the administrations have watered down or ignored. And, you know, like Time Warner
merged with AOL back in the 90s. Now Comcast, NBC Universal, and now they're taking over Time Warner, and so on and so on. And so we're getting this giant, it's because at the end of the day, it's the content. Having wires in the ground is one thing, that's great, but what do you send over it? Movies, music, you know, people want things off of it. Who controls that, drives, you know, that's the last leg in the tripod there, controlling that pipe that gets it to your house. Then you really have total, you know, malefaction control over what's going on. So that, I mean, how can we roll some of that media consolidation back, or is that just Pandora's box and it's just done?
Yeah, I mean, I think it's hard to roll back media consolidation. I mean, I'm no fan of it myself. I spent 25 years of my career trying to stop consolidation, not being very successful, I might add. I think what we want to do at the FCC is create opportunities for new players through spectrum policy, through community broadband, through, you know, things like pole attachments, while at the same time looking very hard. Look, we've got two big transactions in front of us. Comcast, Time Warner Cable, AT&T, DirecTV. I can't say much more than we're looking at it, but we're looking at them very, very hard. And, you know, I know you guys don't follow this, but we've been asking for tens of thousands of pages of documents from those companies, and we're looking at the programming contracts that they enter into, that the, you know, AT&T and Comcast enter into with programmers. So we're looking at these transactions harder, I think, than any FCC has ever looked at transactions. And I'll say another thing. We have an enforcement bureau that is run now by a prosecutor. Okay. In the past, our enforcement bureau has been sort of like, you know, not all that important to the agency. But Chairman Wheeler cares deeply and has hired this guy from Kamala Harris in California's office. He's a prosecutor. He's already gotten, you know, several tens of millions of dollars, well, actually several hundreds of millions of dollars from a couple of big companies for slamming and cramming. You know, that's basically third-party charges that you didn't ask for that land up on your bill. Or sometimes telephone companies just switch you to another telephone company without your authorization. We fine Verizon for a violation of our privacy rules. So this guy is hot to trot and really looking for cases to bring when our rules are violated. But I will say that's the exception, not the rule. But Chairman Wheeler's mantra is competition, competition, competition. So these transactions are going to be looked at with the finest tooth comb that have ever been put to a transaction before.
And let me just add that the chairman is also looking at how you define over-the-top services as a competitor to traditional video and content. And as you all see with streaming companies like Netflix or Hulu, or as HBO and Amazon enter, that really is the new competitive force on the content side. The commission's taking steps. Congress needs to do something called retrans reform so that you change the old laws of how the broadcasters negotiate with different distributors for their content. And that would help repair a broken market in video programming and video content. The other big thing is the cost of video is so high for a new entrant deploying new networks that they're not building those networks because you need not only internet service but video offerings. They have to be bundled together. And if we can fix the video market, it will help deploy new networks because it lowers the cost of a key input, programming content. And so that's something that we're trying to work to achieve in a broad reform congressionally, and to work with the FCC to repair that market.
Just real quick, I think there's a little bit of an interesting twist happening in the world today where, sure, you've got the agglomeration of content or whatever you want to call it, media. At the same time, you also have a rise of the cord cutters who are going left, right, and every which direction to get their media. So, you know, I almost wonder if the timing, you know, it looks like it's all big, bad, and scary, but the reality is they're going to be irrelevant in a couple of years anyway. I don't know. I think it's something to watch.
We have time for at least one or two more questions. Please be quick.
Hi, I'm David. You mentioned earlier that municipalities, San Antonio and in Connecticut, were interested in doing their own local gigabit networks. recently, didn't Texas ban fracking? And I'm not here to debate the merits of that. But almost immediately, the Texas legislature started a bill to prevent municipalities from banning fracking. I thought that was an interesting
parallel. They were going to vote to require it.
What's that?
They didn't vote to require fracking.
Right. So I guess my question is, obviously, if the local broadband takes off, I would imagine the dark triad is going to start lobbying at the state level to try to prevent that from taking off. Do you think that they'll be successful in those efforts, or?
I don't think so, and I'll tell you why. I mean, this is one of the other effects of our decision to preempt the North Carolina and Tennessee laws. I think it would be impossible now for the ISPs to run to the state legislatures under color of night, because that's what they did, right? They started to get these laws passed about, what, 6, 7, 8 years ago, when nobody understood how important it was. And since, I say in the last 2 or 3 years, since people have become aware, A, of the lack of competition they have locally, and B, of the success of a lot of these networks, the ISPs haven't even tried. They did try in Missouri, okay, actually. A bill was introduced in the Missouri legislature, get this, that would prohibit the public sector from engaging in any business the private sector engages in.
So it's illegal to have public buses?
They went whole
hog. Public schools?
So that would be transportation, postal, whatever. So, but for the most part, this is one of those things that for many years nobody knew what was going on. Now people are looking for it. And I just don't think, I think it would be very, very difficult to get one of these laws passed again. And just to clarify, San Antonio wants to build, but they cannot because Texas has one of those restrictive laws.
So San Antonio might be, could be, an entity that would go bring their complaint or petition the FCC, and the FCC now might assert the same logic and authority as it did in the recent two cases and overturn the Texas law. And the real key there being, you ask mom for something and she says no, and you ask dad for something and he says yes, and well, in that household, maybe, what dad says goes. So in this case, the Texas state legislator can want what they want, but when the federal authority overrules them, nothing they can do.
All right.
That's actually the perfect lead into my question. How likely are large companies, partly the telecommunications companies, but also multinational properties, likely to try and use something like TPP to do an end run around various open internet things, just in general? And TPP, the Trans-Pacific...
Partnership Agreement.
Yeah.
What does do an end run mean?
It's a treaty.
It's a treaty, and
yeah,
so...
the Trans-Pacific Partnership Agreement.
It's being negotiated.
What's the Enron reference?
I don't know.
No, it's an end run. So the question is, just at an abstract level, like the carriers will try to win at the cities by controlling them and killing competition. Then they'll try to move up to the state if they don't win at the city. Then they'll try to go to the federal government if they don't win at the state level. And then if they lose at the federal level, they go to the treaty level. They fight at every level. And so the question is sort of generally, I guess, will the carriers go to the federal level or the international level? They always do. I don't know how they would on open internet, though.
This is actually...
This includes Europe as well, not the TPP, but yeah. In general.
And it could work the other way around, because there's a number of international carriers very interested in having special access in the U.S. who would like to use treaties to put pressure on the U.S. to change its rules. So I think it could work the other way around, imposing pressure for greater competition on the U.S. market. Maybe.
And actually, we're working with companies like SoftBank and Vodafone, British Telecom, to open up the U.S. market to more competition.
Yes, sir.
Hello, my name is Cole Perricone. My question was, with the new powers of the FCC, we all know our favorite agencies like the IRS, where you can get a conflict or you need resolution, and it can take years and tons of money to reach that. So I know Comcast and folks like that have the sort of clout to address things and tie it up in court forever. But for smaller entities that are trying to do that and they have to go through FCC to get their neutral ground, I think that discounts a lot of smaller businesses. And I don't know if if having ubiquitous FCC control over the internet would really fix that.
Luckily, that's not what happened.
Yeah.
But, John, go ahead.
Well, I do want to say that there is a risk that I am concerned about, and that is that if the regulatory scheme is set up such that, you know, I as a business have to prosecute a complaint at the FCC, which means hiring lawyers and going at it as a fight, that could be very expensive for me. You know, a larger entity may not have a problem with that, but you know, if it's $500,000, $1 million or more, I don't know how much they go for. Scott McCullough, who does this stuff, he knows exactly what we're talking about. You know, it can be expensive to go prosecute a complaint at a regulatory body, but you know, it depends, and you know, I don't know how it's going to play out here. That's something, as an operator, we are paying attention to that, and we're paying attention to how the language is written and how it reads, to what our strengths are and what level of resources it's going to take to go and get something decided in our favor. So yeah, it's a concern.
Right, but I think the experience of the 2010 rules that we had for 4 years is very instructive. They basically self-regulate. You know, having rules on the books tempers the ISPs from doing bad stuff. And I really think we did not see a run on the bank, so to speak, when the 2010 rules came out. And these rules are very similar to the 2010 rules, except they're under stronger authority, Title II authority. Now, the interconnection's a little bit different. There, I think you may see complaints, but that's not going to be the little guys, right? Those are going to be Netflix, Level 3, Cogent. These are not small companies, okay? So, you know, I still think even in that area, having rules applying Title II to interconnection will moderate bad behavior. But certainly when it comes to the bright line rules and the connection to the consumer, I really don't think that there are going to be a lot of complaints and a lot of litigation going on, because the companies have rules, they have clarity, which they didn't have before, and I think that will moderate bad behavior.
I think the bright line rules are going to be much stronger in terms of dissuading the bad guys from doing the bad things. I think on the interconnection side, you know, you're back to that feudal system where if you pledge your allegiance to Cogent and Cogent goes to battle for you, you're good. But if you pledge allegiance to somebody else who's not willing to go to battle for you, then you have a problem. So I'm fingers crossed, but we got to watch. We got to keep our eyes open and don't take it for granted and work it through.
Yes, sir.
Yes. Does anyone else have some questions? We've generally let it go, but I think maybe some of the panel wants to go, but any other questions, come forward now. Hold your peace. We come on up, ma'am.
All right. So I installed a tool called UniProbe, and I ran it on my local connection on Time Warner Cable. And it showed me a list of sites that are blocked, actually censorship events here in the United States, here in Austin, websites that I can't get to that I didn't even know until I ran this tool that checks against, you know, Tor and then checks against my local connection, right? And my question is, will net neutrality protect me so that I can view these sites, mp3search.com, all these sites that are blocked on my local connection, or is it just for these corporations?
It's absolutely for you, okay? I mean, the FCC is tasked with protecting the public interest, not protecting particular corporate interests. And, you know, we look at the effect that it has on the consumer and also on the edge provider. But the whole purpose of this exercise is to protect the consumer's access to the broadest amount of information possible. That's job one. But we also know that the public has thrived and loves these applications and services, right? That's what you want access to. So the only way you're going to be happy as a consumer is if these edge providers can do their thing without having to ask permission from ISPs.
So Baron Soka, Tech Freedom.
Hello.
So the FCC, among other things in its order, has just announced that they can use forbearance even without doing a competition analysis, which means that when the Republicans take over the FCC, they could use that precedent to gut not only this order, but anything else they want anywhere in the act. So that's on the one hand. On the other hand, the FCC keeps promising that they only want to use Title II just for net neutrality, not for a host of other problems. But of course, some other commission, whether it's a Democrat or Republican commission, isn't going to be bound by that promise. They could use Title II for anything. So my question is, given that this could be a political football in either way, and that the FCC could do much more or much less, depending on who's in power, and that the FCC may just lose completely on all of this, not least because it wouldn't take the time to put out one more notice and spend a month getting a final round of comments, why wouldn't we be better off with legislation that is narrowly tailored to net neutrality harms, doesn't invoke Title II, doesn't let the FCC rewrite the entire Communications Act however it sees fit?
Bit of definition, forbearance is when the FCC can say, well, there's all these rules that are in Title II of the Communications Act, we are not going to apply these to this case because they were written for voice service and they don't affect broadband.
So there's been an effort recently after the FCC's strong order and sort of a signaling that they would go in that direction. There's been an effort now to pass legislation, perhaps. Now, just to be clear, the people who are mainly pushing for legislation have been opposed to net neutrality for a long time. At least they were seen as opponents of net neutrality. And so all of a sudden they say, oh, let's do legislation. And the discussion draft and the kind of proposals out there had what I would consider to be loopholes. But if there were legislation written by Marvin Amory and Chip Pickering, I would vote for it because I would have written it. And that is actually more permanent than an FCC solution. I do think that the FCC, what they have done, is strong and will stand up in court. And when it comes down to it, when you have a majority, you can do things, right? And so, if you can convince a majority of commissioners to adopt a really strong rule, then they will do it. And so going forward, we've got to make sure that we can continue to persuade Congress and the FCC that they should be on your side, not on the side of Comcast and Verizon, to the detriment of you.
Well, I'll just say a couple things. First of all, it's not the next FCC cannot just snap their fingers and undo what we've done. They'd have to engage in a proceeding, and this was a long and painful one. And that proceeding would have to be subject to judicial review. So it's just not that easy for the next FCC to either re-regulate or deregulate, for that matter. That's number one. Okay. Number two is, nobody said we reclassified just to do net neutrality. Okay. We are preserving our ability to protect privacy in the broadband world. I think people want that. We're preserving our... Yeah, do people want their privacy in the broadband world? Okay, we're preserving our ability to protect people from ISPs ripping them off through slamming and cramming and hidden fees. Do people want that? Do people want to be protected from third-party fees that they didn't pay for?
Do
people want the ability to go after telephone companies who just switch you to another telephone company? We want to do those things, and we think the American people want us to do those things. Let me say one other thing, Barron, and this responds to your tweet from my South by Southwest panel this morning. Okay, let me explain to you how administrative law works. The FCC puts out a proposal for rules. That's what we did in May of 2014. It wasn't very popular, okay, but we put out proposals. We said we did propose that we follow a different legal path through Section 706 of the Telecommunications Act of 1996, okay, which net neutrality opponents now love. They used to hate it, but now they love it. Okay, we put out this proposal, but we also said at the same time, Title II is on the table, and if we were to go the Title II route, tell us what we should forbear from. And also, by the way, we're considering applying net neutrality open internet rules to mobile for the first time. Tell us how we can do that. All of that was laid out in a notice of proposed rulemaking in May 2014. So to say now that what we did is completely contrary to our proposal is just false. We laid out two ways to go. You know, Chairman Jenikowski originally was going to go Title II, and he went to 706. I didn't hear anybody complain. Well, I complained about it when I was at public knowledge, but you know, we didn't say process foul. Okay, that's the whole point of public comment. Even though we had a presumption that we were going to go a certain direction, 4 million people told us to go in a different direction. Not all 4 million, but the vast majority of them. So we can change our mind. That makes us a good agency, not a bad agency. The FCC has never put out a full proposal for comment when at the same time it circulates to the other commissioners. Let me just explain how it works. 3 weeks before we vote, wow, everybody's quiet now. 3 weeks before we vote on an item, it circulates to the other commissioners. It comes to the chairman's office. It goes to the other commissioners so they can deliberate and figure out whether they want to offer edits. Never in the history of this agency has that been made public at the same time. Now, maybe that would be a good thing to do in the future, but to all of a sudden, in this particular matter, you know, snap your fingers and do it differently than it's been done for 80 years, no. Okay, so there's no process foul here. We did what we've always done, and we did it in the right way in compliance with the laws that govern this kind of rulemaking. So I'm proud of my agency, I'm proud of my boss, and I'm proud of the public. And I got nothing more to say. Nothing. Can we be done?
Thank you, everyone. This has been an amazing panel. We're done?
We'll have one question from Twitter. We have to wrap it up that way. Someone just said, is this going to allow us to protect privacy better? I did notice that the FCC did not forbear Section 222. Am I remembering that right?
Listen to what we've done, okay? So we did not forbear. So in other words, we are applying the part of the Communications Act, Section 222, who gives a damn what the number is, right, that allows us to protect privacy. And we've done that in the online. What we did forbear from the actual rules that implemented Section 222. Why? Because those rules were for telephone, and it doesn't make any sense in a broadband world to, you know, try to protect the same information you would in a telephone system. So in April, we're going to have a workshop to try to figure out what does it mean to protect privacy in a broadband network world. And we're really going to need a lot of public input because we are eventually going to do a proceeding to adopt new rules. So that's the next step there.
Will a Verizon super cookie be part of that discussion by any chance?
Rob, don't, you know, yeah.
Yeah, it is.
I can't say that. I mean, come on. We don't even have the rules yet and you're telling me to adjudicate? No, I'm not adjudicating. Don't ask me that question.
It sounds like to me.
let me just say this real quickly. The FCC and the staff, a lot of people look at Washington and public service very skeptically, and they should. It is well-deserved and earned. But in this case, the FCC, it was really one of the most open, most participatory, and as Gigi talked about, it's not only the last year, this has been really a 10-year process. Through multiple chairmanships, multiple commissions, both Republican and Democrat, to get to this decision point with the strongest legally sustainable rules possible. And I can tell you, having worked with Gigi and the rest of the FCC staff, they were working untold hours. They had unlimited access and meetings. They were in constant discussions and negotiations with people on both sides of the issue. And even the commissioners who disagree and dissented were doing a great public service. So this was actually, an opportunity to see American government function and function well and come out with good rules and a good decision for something that really is one of the most valuable American inventions and contributors to our country in our lifetime. So I'm very proud to commend the FCC for what they've done, but also to congratulate all of those who participated in the process. So thank you.
I want to thank all y'all and all of you for asking your questions. If you have others in mind, I'm going to be around for a little while. You can ask me. You're going to be around a little bit?
I'll be around. And I should just say, like, what an amazing panel. Like, what an all-star panel that you guys put
the moderator was only okay.
No, and even, I mean, just amazing that we were able to do this. So thank you for the organizers, to Golden Frog, to everyone else. Just really an honor to be on this panel.
All right. Thanks.
I'm having deja vu. Did I see this panel last year here? Or you were not, but a lot of these voices were... No, I'm imagining this.
I don't know what I spoke about last year.
Okay.